Think about a serial killer. It's probably a man. Most likely a loner living in a private fantasy world. His murders are a closely guarded secret. And he's desperate to keep them that way. But there is another type. The serial killer who is not alone.
Childhood was actually of its kind relatively happy. Her father was a distant and shadowy figure in her life, there's no doubt about that, but so were many working class fathers in those days. She was very much loved by her granny, and a lot has been made of the fact that she lived with granny rather than with mum, but the two houses were within sight of each other. Gran loved having her there, and I think Gran and mum made up for any deficiencies on the part of the father.
So in most of the ways that count, it was a fairly typical childhood?
It was a very typical of its time childhood, of its time and place. It was working class, it was a terraced house, there wasn't much money, but it was the same as everybody else in her peer group.
You stood in the nude by the mirror and picked out a rose in the bouquet.
Manchester, what kind of childhood did Brady have?
For a child reared in the Gorbals, a slum in Glasgow, it was a hard life. They were very poor, and he had to fend for himself. If that's normal, then yes, he led a reasonably normal childhood. But there was emotional distance. He was an empty child. He knew that he didn't belong. He hadn't got a father figure to help him, to discipline him. But plenty of people end up leading normal lives after that beginning, except that in his case, there was some kind of a mental breakdown.
How old is he when this happens?
He was about 14 or 15. He did explain. He's cycling along. He feels he's got to get off and stand in a doorway because something's happened to him, a stroke or whatever. I can't explain it, but that's when he saw this face of death, a green image that he rationalized in terms of a face of death.
And lay down beside me again, and I watched the rose on the pillow as it fell. I sank and I slept in a twilight with only one care. To know that when day broke and I woke, that you'd still be there, you'd still be there. The hours, for once, they pass slowly, unendingly by, like a sweet breeze on a field.
Fred explained that here, Brady became more alienated still, setting himself apart from the world and becoming fanatical about disturbing literature. There was the works of the Marquis de Sade, who gave the world sadism, and a growing obsession with the Nazis.
He was no longer somebody who could empathize with normal human beings and a stable community. He needed a kind of philosophy that made sense of the way he felt, and the Nazi philosophy offered that. Here was a a regime, a group of people that were remorseless, who were willing to accomplish their deeds at any price, and he empathized with it.
Your gentleness came down upon me, and I guess I thank you when you caused me to yield. We spoke not a sentence, took not a footstep beyond our 2 days together, which seemingly soon would be gone, soon would be gone. Don't tell me of love everlasting and other sad dreams I don't want to hear. Just tell me of passionate strangers who rescue each other from a lifetime of cares. 'Cause if love me...
Already, at this early stage in their relationship, the foundations are being laid for a truly terrible killer couple, with Ian the driving force and Myra the front person, initially for the most mundane of tasks.
She pays the bus fare. If they're on the bus together, it's always her that pays the fare. If they need fags, she's the one that goes into the shop or the pub and buys them. He waits outside. And this develops, I mean, later on when he decides he wants some guns, it's Myra who has to join a gun club and subsequently illegally buy some guns. When they want to travel around and ultimately carry bodies around, it's Myra who has to get a van and drive, not Ian Brady. She's always the facilitator, the one that allows the things to happen, and she is definitely the front person.
Expecting nothing returned, and I hope I'll be given another whole lifetime to learn. You gave to me, oh, so many things. It makes me wonder how they could belong to me. And I gave you only my dark eyes, which melted your soul down to the place where it belongs. I've spent a whole night in a twin bed with a stranger. His warm arms all around me. How long since I've gazed in the dark eyes that melted my soul down to a place where it longs to be. All of your history has little your face. You're mainly a mystery with violence filling in space. You stood in the nude by the mirror and picked out a rose in the bouquet in our hotel and lay down beside me again, and I watched the rose on the pillow as it fell. I sank and I slept in a twilight with only one care, to know that when day broke and I woke, that you'd still be there, you'd still be there. Hours for once they pass slowly, unendingly by, like a sweet breeze on a field. Your gentleness came down upon me, and I guess I thank you when you caused me to yield. spoke not a sentence, took not a footstep beyond. Our 2 days together, which seemingly soon would be gone, soon would be gone. Don't tell me of love everlasting and other sad dreams. I don't want. Tell me of passionate strangers who rescue each other from a lifetime of cares. 'Cause if love means forever, expecting nothing returned, then I hope I'll be given another whole lifetime to learn. So many things, it makes me wonder how they could belong to me. And I gave you only my dark eyes, which melted your soul down to the place where